I can't say it.
It's your birthday?
You gotta tell them right.
Thank you. angel said to them, "Fear not, behold, I bring you good news of a great joy that will be for all the people.
Yeah. anyone touches.
Thank you.
There we go. All right. Good evening and Merry Christmas, everyone. Yeah. Thank you for being a part of our night. I woke up yesterday morning at 5 o'clock, and the first words out of my mouth were, "It's almost here." Like, I've been so waiting for this moment, waiting for this time for us to gather as a church body, as members of the community of Fergus Falls, as family members of people who attend the NAS. We just want to say welcome to our Christmas Eve service. We just want to say thank you so much for being a part of our time together. There is nothing in our book that is more thrilling than having all of us together to worship our Lord in the same place. And a few of us have commented throughout the weekend of just how wonderful would this be for every Sunday to be like this day, that we can all gather in one place, worship the same Lord. It would just be so fantastic. But we just want to say Merry Christmas to you. We prayed for you. We prayed for this service before we started this afternoon. And the one thing that really came out for us is the last thing we want for this service to be is any kind of production. We want it to be about the praise of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. And we want to invite you to worship Him as we worship Him. We want to invite you to celebrate His arrival as we celebrate His arrival. And we just ask that you would come with open hearts, open minds to what the Lord would have to say to us, that you would, as you feel led, express your praise and worship to our Heavenly Father for the greatest gift that has ever been given to us. My name is Clay. I'm the lead pastor here at the NAS. If we have not met, and this is our worship team, just a tremendous, tremendous group of people who are here to lead us in worship. But before we launch into worship, we're going to ask that you remain seated for the first song. We're going to say just a quick prayer to dedicate our time to the Lord. The band will lead us, and Luke, our team leader, will instruct you as to when you can stand, and we will worship together as the body. Would you bow your heads in these next few moments, and let's lift our time to the Lord. Heavenly Father, truly, just what a blessing, what an encouragement it is, Father, to just simply be in your presence. Father, for us as your body, as your children, as your sons and daughters, to come to one place, to one room, Father, to lift high your name, to say thank you for the gift of your Son, Jesus, and what He has done for us. And God, may nothing in this place be about us, may it be about nothing that we do, may it be fully about you and fully for you. We love you this evening, Lord. We pray that you'd be honored and glorified by everything that takes place in this room tonight. Would you be the center of attention? We love you. We pray all of these things in your name. And all God's people said, amen.
Thank you.
Please stand and worship with us.
Yes.
nature sing, and heaven and nature sing, and the heaven and nature sing.
Salvation. Jesus, we come like the wise men and women of all generations seeking to worship the King of Kings and also seeking the best this life and the life to come has to offer. Peace and love and joy, all made possible through a committed, intentional relationship with you. Lord, we seek peace from the trials of this world by worshiping you, the Prince of Peace. Jesus, we pray that each one here feels enveloped by the embrace of your intense, unconditional, incomprehensible love, a love best understood when we seek and worship you, the author of love. And finally, Lord, we pray that each one here would be filled with a contagious, overflowing, inspiring power of joy in the Spirit that proclaims to the world, joy is possible, and so is love and hope and peace, and it is found in Jesus. Amen. Please take a moment and share that joy with each other. Yes, for you.
And I too want to extend a Merry Christmas to each one of you. It's great to be here in this place all worshiping together. See, we have to take an offering. I shouldn't say have, we get to take an offering, and I'd like the ushers to come forward right now. We don't normally take an offering on Christmas Eve, but since there's no Sunday service tomorrow, we want to give all of our regular attenders one last chance to worship through giving before the end of the year. I want to let the guests know that this offering is not for you, so don't feel any guilt or obligation in giving. This is for those who call the church, the NAS, their church home. Ushers, you may begin. You may remain seated, and the worship team is going to lead us in one more song.
Shepherds, God, and angels sing. Haste, haste to
these past several weeks as we've been talking about on Sunday mornings, A Simple Christmas. I've come to just look back over a number of Christmases in my life. Christmases for me as a kid with just my mom and my stepdad, spending some Christmases in Nebraska with my grandmother, and experiencing Christmas as a newlywed, just my wife and I, Christmas as a dad. And I've come to realize, and I think it's true of so many of us, the things that make Christmases the most meaningful are often just the simplest of things. Card games after meals, the pre-Christmas, Christmas gift rituals, all of these things, the simple things just make Christmas incredibly meaningful. And I think it's in us, I know it's in me, but especially within the context of our culture, I think it's within us to overdo Christmas, to just overcomplicate Christmas. And for some of us, that might look like finding the perfect Christmas tree. And for you, it may not even have to be a natural Christmas tree. It could just be finding the perfect pre-lit, 8-foot spruce, not fir, I combined them. Maybe you could do that. Who knows? That might be the perfect one. Or it could be finding the natural one where you and your family, against their better judgment, and maybe yours, you load everybody in the car and we go traipsing out into the woods and cut down the perfect tree. That might be you guys. For some of us, it might be having like the perfect Christmas family meal. It's the perfect place setting for all of the silverware, for all of the plates, and all you ask for is just a very peaceful meal where everybody is just satisfied and filled, and it's just the perfect Christmas meal. For some of us, it might be the Christmas lights. It might be, I'm going to outdo Clark Griswold once and for all. Like, it's just going to be the best house in the block. We have to call the power plant and tell them we're putting up Christmas lights so they can, provide extra power to the city. That might be you. For some, and this was my mom, it was giving the perfect gift. It was giving the perfect gift of something that I had been hoping for, or someone in our family had been hoping for months. That thing had been on our Christmas list, for as long as we could remember. And maybe for you, it's like you want to get the gift that one person is hoping for. Or maybe you were a little bit like me, and you couldn't wait to receive the gift that you've been hoping for weeks or maybe months. But it brings up a question for us as we gather here tonight. What are you hoping for this Christmas? What do you hope for this Christmas? It's interesting because I think as people, we are all hardwired for hope. Hope is what keeps many of us going. For me as a kid, Christmas Day was the big day to unwrap presents. But it didn't come first thing in the morning. For us, our family prepared the meal in the morning and sat down at the perfect place setting, for dinner. And then we couldn't even dive into the presents after that. We actually had to clear the table. And then we had to clean the dishes. And we had to put away the dishes. And I just could not wait to find out if I was getting what I'd been hoping for weeks. And I remember my 8-year-old self, this is an honest confession, I remember my 8-year-old self looking into the kitchen and seeing my grandmother doing the dishes and thinking, is there not anyone in this home that can do dishes faster than her? I really want to get to the presents. You can tell where my priorities were at the time. Before Amazon Prime ever came onto the scene, many of you are going to remember this. Before the virtual Christmas list online with Amazon was the coveted JCPenney Christmas catalog. That was probably twice the thickness of my Bible here, and pictures of anything you could ever dream of for sale. And my chore, my job, every October and November was get the JCPenney Christmas catalog, get a blue pen, and circle all of the things that you want for Christmas. And I circled G.I. Joes, I circled bicycles, I circled BB guns, I circled about anything a little 8-year-old boy could ever think or want or dream of. Now, there was one thing, however, that I circled every year and never received. And it wasn't even one of those, you know, you circle it and you hope for it and, you know, you open all of the presents under the tree and once the, you know, the tissue is settled and, you know, the calm has come back across the house, it wasn't even one of those of, oh, what's this in the closet? Oh, there's one more. Nope, not even that. You know, it wasn't the surprise one waiting in the basement. This gift literally never came. Do you want to see what it was? It was this. You as parents are laughing for a completely different reason than your children, which I've come to find out. In my 8-year-old mind, I never could understand why I never got one of these for Christmas. Why would my mom not want me to experience the pleasure and joy of beating on things and making loud noises? That's what 8-year-old boys are supposed to do. Now, I understand my mom was much wiser than I, in that I had A, never played an instrument before in my life, and B, I have no rhythm. I literally, and you can ask my wife on this, I literally cannot sing and clap my hands in rhythm at the same time. If I can tap to the beat and sing, but somehow two hands throw something off, and I just can't do it. But that was the one thing that I asked for every single year and never ever received. And some of us have heard the phrase, you know, you need to be careful what you hope for. And I think we know that. As adults, we realize that many of the things that we hope for, and even as kids, many of the things that we hope for and maybe even receive don't really have a long shelf life. Either we lose interest and we throw it, you know, off to the side, but ultimately, in the long run, many of those things will rust out. They'll just go away. We'll end up tossing them out. They won't hold our hope many times like we think they will. So another question. Have you ever hoped for something that you've never received? Have you ever hoped for something that you've never received? See, many of our hopes this time of year go beyond just Christmas gifts. Some of us have hoped and are hoping for maybe an engagement. Maybe some of us are hoping for that promotion. We're hoping to finish our degree so that we can get that better job. Maybe some of us are waiting for our license to drive. Like, it just can't come soon enough. Some of us might hope that the depression would lift sometime soon. Some of us might hope that the marriage doesn't dissolve. Some of us would hope that the diagnosis is not what we fear the most. We have some pretty sizable things that we hope for. And many of us know the despair and the discouragement, the disappointment that comes from hopes that go unfulfilled. And there's a very important question that we need to ask in those times. Where do you turn when your hopes are just dashed? When you realize that the things that you hope for really aren't going to come to fruition? Some of us are like me with that drum set, and that we've come to the conclusion that that's never, ever going to happen. And so we stop asking. And we stop hoping, and we give up. It's just never going to come. See, hope is essential for life. We can endure the loss of a lot of things, but hope is not one of them. It is essential for our lives. And one of the most dangerous and detrimental things to hope is a long wait. A long wait between our ask and when the answer comes. The long wait between the promise of something new or something better and the actual delivery of that promise. That's a difficult place to find ourselves. But what we find in the Old Testament especially is we understand that the people of God, that the nation of Israel, understood what it meant to wait. They understood that sometimes between the ask and the answer, or the promise and its delivery, there's going to be some time. Abraham was promised to have a son with his wife Sarah. at 75 years old. I mean, chances are that's not happening to any of us. And there would be a sense of urgency because we're not getting any younger. But it wasn't for another 25 years that son finally came. Abraham understood what it meant to wait. Moses and the nation of Israel understood what it meant to wait for the fulfillment of a promise. After being delivered out of slavery from Egypt, they had to wait 40 years. 40 years, my lifetime, before they could enter into the promised land. The prophet Isaiah gave God's people the promise of a coming Savior, of Emmanuel, of God is with us. And hope began to rise up in people. Hope began to rise up in the nation because things were not good. But that promise would not be fulfilled for another 700 years. That's a long wait. The prophet Malachi, as we have in our Bibles, it's the last book in the Old Testament. He gives the last words to the people of God. The last words that they hear for 400 years. And the next voice they hear is the arrival of the Messiah. And what I find interesting is that in most of our Bibles, between the Old Testament and the New Testament, between Malachi and Matthew, between the prophets and Jesus, there's usually a white page, just a blank page. And that blank page represents 400 years of waiting, 400 years of silence, 400 years of nothing. And here's what we know, is that one page, that time of silence, that time of nothing, is where your hope and my hope is put to the test. Because it will either die or it will thrive in the midst of the wait. And some of you might find yourselves on a blank page in your life right now. The thing you've been hoping for and praying for and asking for just simply has not come about. But there's something that we can learn in the midst of that silence, in the midst of that page, in the midst of the nothing, in the midst of the wait, that can actually help us find hope. See, for hope to thrive in the wait, we have to stop asking the question, what am I hoping for this Christmas? And we have to ask ourselves a better question. And the better question we have to ask ourselves is, who am I hoping in this Christmas? Because you and I can hope for things that ultimately won't last. Or we can hope in someone who will always last. And there's a vast difference between those two. There's a vast difference in the outcome of our lives based on which question we choose to ask ourselves. And that question is the key to having a simple hope. The key to having a simple hope. And simple hope is just that the satisfaction of our eager and expectant souls that is only found in the person of Jesus Christ. And maybe what we find in the wait is exactly what we need to allow hope to reign in our hearts. Which is exactly what happened to Zechariah. Zechariah is found in Luke chapter 1, and we've not really talked about him a whole lot, and he's part of the Christmas story, but he's married to a woman named Elizabeth. They are both very old. They are beyond childbearing years, but they are both very godly people, and they've wanted a child for years, but she is barren, and they cannot have children. Zechariah was also a Jewish priest in the temple of God. And he was in church all the time. And part of his duties was to burn incense at the altar of the Lord 2 times a day. Which was significant because when he would light these fires, the smoke would rise to the skies, rise to the heavens, and the people would gather around and they would pray. And that smoke was highly symbolic of their prayers reaching the heavens to the ears of God so that he could respond. And in the midst of one of these times, Luke chapter 1 verse 11 talks about a shift that happens for Zechariah. Verse 11 says, "Then an angel of the Lord appeared to him, standing at the right side of the altar of incense. When Zacharias saw the angel, he was startled and was gripped with fear. But the angel said to him, 'Do not be afraid, Zachariah. Your prayer for a son has been heard. Your wife Elizabeth will bear you a son, and you are to call him John. He will be a joy and a delight to you, and many will rejoice because of his birth, for he will be great in the sight of the Lord.'" See, simple hope is significant. It's significant because God gives you and I a life-changing gift. John, this boy, was a life-changing gift for Zechariah and for his wife Elizabeth. It changed everything for them. But it was also the beginning of a tremendous gift for the world. Because in his arrival, the angel tells Zechariah, "Your son John is going to precede the Messiah. He's going to go before and prepare people's hearts for the message that he will give them. For the greatest life-changing gift that the world will come to see and know." But the problem was, so many people misunderstood why Jesus was coming to the earth. They wanted a deliverer that would take them out from under the rule of Rome. They wanted political power. They wanted religious power. They wanted social and world power. But God's gift to them was none of those. God's gift to them in Jesus was personal salvation for all who would call on them. And because they misunderstood it, so many people in their time kind of said this prayer to God. "That's it? That's the God. That's the Messiah? That's what you want to do? That's not what I want in a Savior." And they completely misunderstood the point of why he was coming. Like this guy that we're about to see, they completely misunderstood what Jesus was about. Watch this.
I wonder what it would be like to be born in a manger.
Yeah. I wonder whatever happened to baby Jesus.
He grew up.
What? Wait. So you're saying that the baby Jesus Christmas story is the same as the adult walk on water Jesus?
Yeah.
Wow, I just never really put the two concepts together. Wonder what happened to that guy, huh?
He went to the cross.
That's the same guy? So what you're saying is baby Jesus is the same as cross Jesus?
Yeah. I mean, there's some time in there, right? I mean, he grew up, he taught people, he lived a perfect life. He died on the cross and came back to life. And, you know, now he lives in our hearts.
That's the same guy? The Jesus that lives in our hearts? Okay, I was really... Oh, wow. Okay. I never really put all those guys together, you know?
Only one guy.
I tell you this. There's an idea. Maybe we stop just making Christmas all just this once-a-year isolated thing, but we make it an ongoing story about the salvation in our hearts and lives.
That's the idea. That's the idea. The sweet baby Jesus that was wrapped in linens for clothing. The same sweet baby that was laid in a wooden manger. The same baby that was worshipped by strangers would also become the man who was stripped of his clothing. The man who was laid out not in a wooden manger, but laid out on a Roman cross and nailed to that wooden cross. And then mocked by the same people, he was forgiving in that same moment. The same Jesus that came as a baby is the same Jesus that we worship today. The Apostle Paul summarized Jesus' arrival to earth and his ultimate mission. Paul said he was handed over to die because of our sin. Your sin and mine. And he was raised to life to make us right with God. And many of us look at that, and our lives would say, that's not the kind of Messiah I want. I want one that serves me. I want one that cleans up after me. I want one that gives me permission to do what I want to do, but I still want his benefits. Our lives would say, that's not the kind of Messiah I want. And that type of mindset allows something to creep in that makes simple hope difficult. It allows doubt to creep into our minds. And simple hope is difficult because doubt in the midst of waiting, doubt in the midst of the blank page, doubt in the midst of the silence can drown out hope. It goes on in verse 18. Zechariah asked the angel, how can I be sure of this? Zechariah, God is saying you're going to have a son. Your prayers have been answered. This is what you've been waiting for. How can this be? How can I be sure of this? I'm an old man and my wife is well along in years. His first response to the thing he'd been praying for years. His very first response is doubt. It's doubt. Now listen, this is incredibly important. He was a priest in the house of God. He offered sacrifices for people. He interceded for people. He was in the house of God all of the time. He was around the things of God. But the things of God were not in him. Those things had not gone from here to here. And the same is true of us. We can be professionally religious about church. We can be professionally religious about God. And we can come and we can be in attendance and we can be polite. We can send our kids to children's church and we can say the right things and we can go through the ups and downs. We can be professionally religious about God and be completely, personally disconnected from him. We can go through the motions at church and we can walk out of this building or any other church building on a Sunday morning and we will continue to live as though he is aloof. Or distant, or even worse, non-existent. The angel says to him in verse 19, I'm Gabriel. I stand in the presence of God, and I've been sent to speak to you and tell you this good news. This is coming straight from the mouth of God. And now, Zechariah, you will be silent and not able to speak until this day happens, because you did not believe my words, which will come true at their appointed time. Which I love that verse, because that means our doubt doesn't change truth. Our doubt doesn't change truth. Doubt changes a lot of things, but it doesn't change God. More severely, doubt changes us. And it changes our perspective. And it changes our outlook on life. It changes our response to people. It changes our view of God. It changes so many things, but it does not change God. It does not change his truth, but it will change us. See, Zechariah's doubt led him to believe that I can go through the routine of church, you know, get the brownie points for being there, but God ultimately is far off. But Gabriel came to say, God is up close and personal with each and every one of you. God is in your business. He knows your business. He knows your life. He knows that it's crazy chaotic. He knows that you are far from him. But guess what? He still wants to draw close to you. He knows your heart. But he wants to be in your heart. And he wants to change your heart. But he tells Zechariah, because you didn't believe, you're going to be silent until your son is born. 9 months to a year. You're not going to be able to talk. To which Elizabeth was saying, yes, thank you.
you imagine not being able to talk for 9 months? Can you imagine what that would be like to live in silence? To not be able to communicate verbally with anyone? But maybe for Zechariah, the 9 month wait was a blessing in disguise. And maybe it is for you as well. Because in those 9 months, Zechariah has time to think. And God has time to stir some things in him. And Zechariah has time to really weigh out the questions. What am I hoping for? And is it really going to last? And he also has some time to really ask the question, who is my hope in? And you have the opportunity to ask those same questions. And you have the opportunity to settle some things, some spiritual things that God has been stirring in your heart, some important decisions that have eternal and spiritual ramifications. And he's offering you the opportunity to ask the question, what am I hoping for? Is it going to last? And maybe more importantly, who is my hope really in? The psalmist said, I remain confident of this. In my desperate situation, I will see the goodness of the Lord in the land of the living. And so what is my response? Wait. Wait. Wait for the Lord. Be strong and take heart and have hope and wait for the Lord. Because when you do, you get to experience the facet of hope, of simple hope that is radical. And that is this. What you find in the wait to discover simple hope is a very simple faith. Because God has time to strip you of everything that you depend on that is not Him. And it's a simple faith in who He is. And now, Zechariah's son is born. And instead of speaking words of doubt, he now has the opportunity to speak words of faith. Words of simple faith and words of life. And the baby is born, and after 8 days, it was their custom to name the child. And so the friends and family that have gathered, you know, gather around Elizabeth. What are we going to name him? Well, you know, what's the name that you guys are choosing? And she says, we're going to name him John. And they all go, what? There's nobody in your family named John. You always name your child after someone in your family. There's no one in your family line named John. Why would you do this? We got to find out from Zechariah what he wants. So they go, jump all the way down to verse 62. It says, then they made signs to his father to find out what he would like to name the child. He asked for a writing tablet, and to everyone's astonishment, he wrote, his name is John. Immediately his mouth was open and his tongue set free, and he began to speak, praising God. The simple statement of simple faith of his name is John meant that Zechariah is choosing God. He's choosing simple faith in the promise of God. That yes, even though I waited, God is still present. He's choosing relationship with God over religiosity about God. And there is a vast difference. But Zechariah knew in that moment who his hope was in. So one last time, who is your hope in this Christmas? Who is your hope in this Christmas? And maybe the Lord has been stirring some things in you that have eternal ramifications, that have spiritual consequences for your heart and for your life and for your family. And you've been speaking words of doubt. I don't see how you can do this. I don't see how this is possible. I've been too far from you. Our family is too dysfunctional. We don't make enough money. I don't know how this can play out. And maybe God has brought you to this place to begin speaking words of faith. A simple faith that acknowledges that in my way, God is present. That God loves me. and wants me and wants to change me. And so we're just going to take an opportunity for you to speak words of faith to our Heavenly Father. And we're going to put a prayer up on the screen, a very simple prayer. And maybe you're in this room and you've been seeking Christ, but you've never surrendered to Christ. And there's all kinds of doubts and all kinds of questions. But let's be honest, hope is not there. You've tried putting your hope in other things, other people, other places, other substances, other lifestyles, and you find it lacking. And maybe you need to change the question of, what am I hoping for? To who am I hoping in? And maybe you've been religious about church, but you're not in relationship with God. Maybe you've been doing this scene for years, and this is just another checklist, you know, another check on the checklist, and I can cross this off and I'm done. But you'd be honest enough to say, I have no hope. The game doesn't accomplish anything. The routine is just that routine. And you need to ask the question and honestly answer, who is my hope in this Christmas? And so I'm just going to read this prayer that's on the screen. And I would invite you, if your heart has been filled with doubt, your hope is hanging by a string, and it doesn't matter if you believed in Jesus for years, you just know you've walked away from Him lately. And it doesn't matter if you've never believed in Jesus, this prayer is for you. And I'm just going to read this prayer out loud. And if you know in your heart of hearts, you need to say this prayer. And you're not saying it to me, you're not saying it to your neighbor. You are speaking to your Heavenly Father who's brought you here because He loves you. And He's given you the life-changing gift of personal salvation found in His Son, Jesus Christ, which He sent to this world because He loves you, to die for your sins and to raise from the dead, to offer you new life and to make you right with God. So I'm just going to turn and I'm just going to say this prayer. And if that's you, you know you have to say this prayer. I'm just going to ask you to say it out loud right where you're seated with me. And the scriptures tell us that the angels in heaven rejoice over one sinner who repents, more than 99 who do not need to repent. God is excited for you to come home. God is excited for you to speak simple faith in His Son. And so we're going to take the opportunity to do that now. Repeat after me or speak it with me if you'd like. Father in heaven, I believe that You love me. Thank You for the gift of salvation. I confess I've sinned against You. I trust Jesus for the forgiveness of my sin. And I commit to follow You as Lord and receive Your gift of eternal life. Help me to live fully for You. In Jesus' name, amen. And I want us as a church, as people of the NAS, to celebrate like the angels do. Because honestly, if one person prayed that prayer tonight, all of this was worth it. All of it was worth it. So would you just praise God right now? Would you just rejoice that someone repeated that prayer right now? It's absolutely worth it. And someone has received new life tonight from Him because of the gift of Jesus. And if you prayed that prayer, I would ask that you would come find me. I'll just be right up here at the front. I want to pray with you. I want to congratulate you. I want to welcome you into the family of God. And if you're a family member, if you're a part of the community, you're a part of the community and you don't have a church home, we want to welcome you as a part of the NAS. And we would invite you to be with us on Sunday mornings at 9 and 10:30. And allow God to just change you. It's not about us. It's about Him and what He does in us and through us and for us. I'm going to invite you to stand, and we're going to sing one more closing song, and then we'll dismiss with prayer. But God is good. God is good. And we want to take this last moment before we leave together to worship. Let's worship together. Thank you.
Have a blessed Christmas Eve, blessed Christmas Day. We love you. You are dismissed.